Did you know that you could go from drowsy and falling asleep to wide awake and productive in 10 seconds if you just look up at light? Or so says the internet's most popular neuroscientist, Andrew Huberman, whose Huberman Podcast YouTube channel has over 1 million subscribers.
What I'm about to describe next is going to seem so silly on the face of it, but it's grounded in some of the most hardwired, meaning present from birth, aspects of our neural circuitry. That system of alertness is linked to the position of our eyes. So when we look up and our eyelids are up, it actually has a purpose. It actually creates a wakefulness signal for the brain.
Welcome to Techforpsych, where we expand minds through at-home neurotechnology. I'm Dr. Cody Rall, your medical doctor confidant who left his cushy Navy job with psychiatry to develop Fitbits for the brain and maximize your performance.
My question is, can we test this effect at home and validate Dr. Huberman's claims? I did a literature review, consulted my neuroscience team, and ran the experiments at home with neuroscience wearables to produce some very interesting results. I was even able to track down and talk to Dr. Huberman's colleague, Dr. Jamie Zietzer. Who Dr. Huberman credits with doing some of the original research and is a world expert on the topic.
I'm on a mission today to test these wild claims with devices that you can buy for $300 to $800, test your own brain at your own home for your own data, and take the science back from those fancy Stanford laboratories behind closed doors. First, I wanted to talk to my friend Will, who works in a neuroscience lab here locally in Las Vegas. He's the one who originally introduced me to the Huberman podcast, so I wanted to get his take on this. I mean, Huberman's podcast is huge. It's like a million followers. For a neuroscience podcast, that's crazy to me.
Yeah.
Why is he so popular? Do you have a sense of feeling of why people enjoy his content and why you enjoy his content?
What he does is he's very aware of his audience, and he goes into deep dives in a way that I think that it's appropriate for people that have some background in some knowledge of the brain, some neuroscience. For someone like at my level, I have some experience working in various neuroscience labs. The deep dives that he does are enough that I can follow most of what he's saying and follow the rabbit trail on my own. And I think there's a lot of people out there that are at that level that like to consume in the service of, as we were talking about, applied neuroscience. He's actually going through the steps that I would think people should want to go through if they wanted to make the most informed decision.
Next, I talked to Scott Burwell at Neurotype and Alex Nee from Divergence on how to properly set up my experimental design for best chance of getting good data.
So, you know, the idea is interesting to me, but there are a lot of scientific questions that I think surround a deep investigation of how to do this sort of test. One way that you could account for the potential artifacts that you're going to get while looking up with your eye movements and with your muscle movements is by just measuring before and after you do that little exercise. And what that does is makes the artifacts or the noise that you see in the signal before and after close enough to one another.
All right, Alex, I really want to test this Andrew Huberman technique where you look up at light and supposedly it's supposed to wake you up. So I've got this Verilux light that is used for seasonal affective disorder. So I think it'll be a good light source. And then I was thinking of using the Neurosity Crown. Do you think this would be a good one to pick up activation patterns in my brain for wakefulness for light?
That's one of the better devices that I would recommend to pick up the brainwave activities with the light.
Do you think it's excitability, or should we look at some different brainwave ratios? What would you say is the best thing to look at for the activation patterns?
Well, there are a couple of things that you could look at, Cody, to start off with. Excitability is definitely a good one. You know, towards the end of the protocol, depending on how long you want to set the light for, more immediately during the session, you could also look at any kind of visual entrainment coming from the sort of posterior region of your brain. So when you're being stimulated with the light, see if there's any EEG change on the posterior sites as opposed to restful normal baseline.
With the blessing of the neuroscientists, I felt more confident in the tools that I was using. So I set up this experiment station in my gear room where I would be sitting on the meditation mat and looking up at the Verilux light, which is suspended by some nice duct tape and a step stool. The idea was that I would wait about a half hour before I normally went to sleep so that I was pretty tired and I'd have to muster the discipline to go do the experiment, sit down on the mat, do a continuous recording, and turn on the light halfway through the recording. I did run into some hurdles. I was moving too much, turning on and off recording software and the light. So I actually had to have my wife help me. She would manage the recording software and the Verilux light during the experiments so I could sit as still as possible and not contaminate the signal. Then when we got our first looks at the data, it looked like there was some kind of electromagnetic contamination. There's probably too many wearables in that room that were affecting the signal. So we moved into the bathroom where there's less wireless devices, obviously, and it was actually darker for the experiment. Also, when we first started out, we were doing one continuous recording, but Scott Burwell was worried about any signals actually coming from the Verilux light itself. So we did go to a block design where we had three different recordings instead of one. To account for the effect from the light, we just left it on throughout all three blocks. So in the end, we did 5 minutes with the light on and my eyes open but blindfolded to simulate darkness, 5 minutes with the light on and me looking at the light to get the light exposure, and then 5 minutes after the light exposure with my eyes open but again blindfolded to simulate more darkness. It was challenging, but I learned a lot about experimental design as well as the capabilities of the Neurosity Crown, Muse Headband, and Mendy when running experiments like this. And we got some really interesting results. But before we do that, let's talk to Dr. Jamie Zietzer, who was so instrumental in the original studies of light exposure for humans and has some interesting viewpoints about where to go with this research in the near future.
I had a discussion with a colleague of mine, Dr. Jamie Zietzer, who's in the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at Stanford, a world expert in this.
Dr. Zietzer.
Hi, hello. Cody, how are you?
Good, how are you doing?
Good, good. Sorry, I'm a little jury-rigged here. My computer is kind of on the fritz, so I'm on the phone right now. But
okay, well, that works. Well, thanks for taking the time.
Sure. So back in the 50s, people thought that, well, humans aren't sensitive to light. There were a bunch of studies that were done, classic studies. All other animals, their circadian clocks are reset by light. Humans are different. We've got these big brains. We can overcome that, and we use social cues. And that was kind of dogmatic for many years until in the 80s, Chuck Seisler, who's my former advisor, is the one who really got this started and started looking at light more carefully and showed that, no, actually, it's light. And here were the methodological problems with the earlier studies. In 2000, then, we kind of established what the lighting parameters were in terms of the intensity responsivity. Then a couple of years later, David Burson showed that there were these ganglion cells in the eye, which we knew about, these ganglion cells that directly project to the circadian clock and other hypothalamic areas, but that they were also directly photosensitive. And that was the big breakthrough. These go to areas of the brain that are involved in mood regulation. It goes to areas of the brain that are involved, obviously, in circadian regulation, in regulation of alertness, simple circuit involved in pupil constriction. I have to say, you know, 20 years ago, we didn't know these cells existed. So, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if we found other functions of light in the brain as well that these cells are kind of contributing to.
As you can see, there's a lot of rich history when it comes to experimentation on how light actually affects the human brain. Let's check in with Scott and Alex to see if the neuroscience wearables were actually able to get any usable data and tell us if the light actually woke my brain up or not.
All right, Scott, good morning. Thanks for taking a look at the data for me.
Absolutely, yeah. I ran it through some of my signal processing algorithms and ways to remove things like artifacts from movement and from electrical interference and such. I was able to pull up a plot here that shows your data. What we have here are the three different 5 minute recordings that you made. When you're looking directly at the light, your brain excitability is nominally increased. This is interesting, and it's consistent with your theory here that it activates circuits in your cortex that's reflected in the EEG.
Without the SAD LED, you've got increased alpha here. With the SAD LED, the alpha increase is very minimal. From 5 hertz onward here with the SAD LED, you've got increased theta in the frontal cortex, which is your executive network.
So as far as my own subjective experience went, the light definitely woke me up, especially when I was nearly falling asleep in the dark waiting for that 5 minute mark. And then as soon as the light came on, it took a little bit for my eyes to adjust, but definitely within a minute, I was feeling quite a bit more awake. The most satisfying result was the excitability data that Dr. Scott Burwell showed us. According to the excitability data, my brain was more awake during the light and actually was more awake than baseline after the light. Another thing that we found that was somewhat unexpected is that my midline theta levels went up with light exposure. I realized that in the dark, my mind was wandering. I was thinking about my daily activities and basically just trying to entertain myself until the light came on. And that is highly correlated with default mode network activation. But when the light went on, there was an object in front of me that I could focus on. And increased levels of midline theta are theorized to correspond with activation of the salient brain network, which involves focus on an external object and your surroundings. Now, because I'm only one subject and we didn't do multiple trials, we can't statistically say that these results are conclusive. But what this experimentation is an example of is an exploratory study, which people can do at home. And I'm excited about because we've now democratized neuroscience wearables, and we can do things like this as a community, find data that's interesting, and follow up with more rigorous studies in the future. I do believe that there's a well-established effect of light on wakefulness, but there are a lot of variables that go into that that Dr. Jamie Zietzer talked about with me on our call. I can't go into every variable or this video would end up being way too long, but different factors that affect how light will actually wake you up can depend on how much sleep you got the night before, how much light exposure you had during the day, at what time you were exposed to the light, and various levels of intensity of light exposure. One thing that Dr. Zietzer did mention is that the effects of the light tend to wear off pretty quickly in terms of wakefulness, but it was great to see in my experiment that it lasted for at least 5 minutes. The Neurosity Crown performed very well with this experiment. We also tried to collect data with the Muse headband, but that data analysis did not show conclusive results. I think what happened is that I tried to do the data collection with the Muse in the gear room, and there was too much interference from other devices that contaminated the signal. I'll have to troubleshoot that experimental design so the next time we use the Muse headband, we can get better data that we can use for more conclusive results. I also tried to use the Mendy to determine if the light was increasing blood flow to my frontal lobe. I made sure to cover the Mendy with the towel to make sure that the external light source was not affecting the Mendy FNIR signal, but the data that I got from it was difficult to interpret. The frontal lobe blood flow did go up throughout the session, but it was difficult to tell if and when it was related to light stimulation that I received in the middle of the experiment. Ultimately, I think I need access to the raw FNIR's data, and I am working with that company to come up with better data analytic tools so that the Mendy hardware can be more effective in collecting data in experiments like this. As far as Dr. Huberman goes, I think his podcast is 10 out of 10. I think he's a world-class communicator in delivering practical neuroscience, applied neuroscience techniques that you can use to improve your life that have a lot of data from clinical and laboratory studies. This project made me really excited about the practical applications of the effects of light on the human brain. Dr. Zietzer is actually working on a wearable that would use flashes of light at night to help reset your circadian rhythm when you are traveling to reduce the effects of jet lag.
We can give a sequence of light flashes just being repeated every 10 seconds or so. What we found is that you can actually give this during sleep. It goes into the eye, gets to the clock, and shifts the clock. If you give these light flashes, if you optimize it the right way, you can get 2 to 3 hours of shift.
Wouldn't that be awesome to use a wearable to sleep much better after changing time zones and feel a lot more rested for your vacation or business trips? There is just so much to explore in terms of applied neuroscience and using these wearables at home. If you want to see how I use them to investigate the effects of alcohol, hitting the alarm clock in the morning, and even video games, check out this video here, and I'll see you on the other side.
1, 2, 3.